Sup, you beautiful bastards. Hope you're having a fantastic Tuesday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show, and let's just jump into it. Today we're going to start off with some light stories because we are taking two deep dives into stories people are going to be passionate about. Let's ease our way in on a story I think most of us can agree on. And so that first thing I want to talk about today is Dani Mathers back in the news, and that name might sound familiar because we've talked about her before. If you don't remember, Dani Mathers is the Playboy playmate who took a naked photograph of an old woman in a gym locker room, sharing it out on her social media without that woman's permission, obviously, and then posting a picture of herself laughing, saying, if I can't unsee this, then you can't either. In reaction to this, there was massive outrage because this is an incredibly shitty thing to do. She was then also banned from LA Fitness Gym, she lost a radio gig, she was fired from that, and she was charged with invasion of privacy. And that means she faces up to 6 months in jail and a $1,000 fine. Now, in the past, I've explained that I think that what she did is disgusting. I think that she should be punished, but I also pointed out that this happened in LA. LA is notorious with not punishing celebrities properly. They also have a big prison problem. The system is so flooded that people that are sentenced for non-violent crimes usually serve like 1/10 of their sentence. But here's what we've seen. Dani Mathers put in a request to have her sentence deferred. And what that request means is instead of maybe incarcerating me, defer my sentence to something like rehab. I'll go to some sort of course where they're like, it's wrong to film people that aren't aware of it in the locker room, and then share that naked footage with the rest of the world without their permission. Who knew? It's a good thing you're in this class to learn that, since that's not just common sense and decency. And in response to this request, the LA City Attorney's Office responded, and I'm paraphrasing here, Bish, what? Saying, defendant petitions the court for a diversion. However, she does not qualify nor merit such leniency. Her post-crime behavior is indicative of the fact that the defendant has never shown remorse for her behavior and therefore should face the consequences of her cruel and criminal act. And then most recently, Mathers tried to argue that the law that she is accused of violating, that privacy law, it is too ambiguous to be constitutional. To which the judge responded, and once again, I'm paraphrasing, bitch, what? The judge saying, the court finds the statute is constitutional and not void for vagueness. And so with that, it seems like we are full steam ahead. The trial should start May 26th. We'll have to wait and see what happens. I just hope that she is held accountable. I've seen people talking about this being a body-shaming trial, but this is an invasion of privacy trial. Maybe if this was accidental, I could excuse it, but it was purposeful, it was mean-spirited, the point was obvious. A naked person in a private setting wasn't caught in the background on accident from someone oversharing selfies of themselves. This was purposeful. Then let's talk about a different kind of body-shaming story, and that revolves around Michaela Maroney. And most people know Michaela for one of two reasons. One, she is a gold medal gymnast. She's part of the Fierce Five in the 2012 Olympic Games. And also because she got memeified with the Not Impressed meme. Well, after all of that, in 2014, she had knee surgery. She would later retire. She's in the news today because a lot of people are freaking out about what she's doing to her image. And that's because she put out this video. At first, a lot of people saying, oh no, Michaela got hacked! And this wouldn't be the first time. Michaela Maroney was also part of that big celebrity photo leak, the Fappening, back in 2014. And those nude photos back then were allegedly underage photos. But as far as this video, Michaela updated saying, I'm not hacked. Unfollow if you need to. All love. And so while there was some support, there were a lot of people saying, oh, this is so sad. So many young girls look up to Michaela. She was so respectable, and now this? And seemingly in response to that, Michaela then posted this picture with the caption, I still wish him well. And here's what I'll say. I just don't understand the hate she's getting. When she was younger, when she was a minor, she focused on gymnastics. That was her life. But now, back in 2017, Michaela is a 21-year-old woman. Maybe she wants to model, maybe this is just for fun, but she is a grown woman doing with her body as she pleases. Unlike those photos that were shared with the entirety of the world without her permission back in 2014, these are photos she is choosing to take and choosing to share. To me, this is almost as if she is taking back control of her body, although I'm probably looking too far into it. The situation. Not the body. I just don't get the outrage, personally. I don't know about you. Then in a tech move that's addressing one of the issues I have with YouTube TV, YouTube TV is adding new channels. Today they added AMC, BBC America, IFC, Sundance TV, and WE TV, which while I don't know what WE TV is, this addition makes it so I can watch my Walking Dead and my Doctor Who. So fantastic. The other issue I have with the service, though, has to do with the ads. In the long term, for me to take this service seriously, they have to do the thing that Hulu did, which is offer an option without ads. If Hulu had to offer an ad-free version because people were angry at that lower tier that they were getting ads, how do you think people feel being charged $35 a month and then on some programming still getting ads? I'm still a fan of the idea, but like I said, when it was first talked about, when it was first announced, I'm going to be critical. Then, according to new reports, the new Pirates of the Caribbean movie is being held for ransom. According to The Hollywood Reporter, Disney CEO informed employees at a town hall meeting on Monday that the perpetrators of the crime informed Disney that they would release the first 5 minutes of the film and continue to leak 20-minute chunks until the ransom is paid, adding that the the company is working with federal investigators on the ransom case and that the huge sum requested will not be paid. Now, this is not the first bit of entertainment ransom we've seen recently. I mean, we just had Orange is the New Black in the news. Hackers tried to get money out of Netflix, saying, if you don't give us money, we are going to release these episodes. Netflix didn't budge, and then they released the episodes. Episodes of the new season are being pirated right now. But there's a big difference here. Orange is the New Black getting pirated, it kind of ends up serving just as this big advertisement for high-quality production on Netflix. When watches it, they like it, they go, oh, maybe, you know what, Netflix is actually worth getting. But with a movie which is very much a purchase experience rather than a subscription experience, they could lose millions of dollars. And I don't mean what you could argue with Orange is the New Black of losing millions of dollars of value. Millions of real-life dollars. This movie is months away from release. And the people that watch pirated version most likely won't also then buy a movie ticket. And this whole situation has me waiting to see what happens. One, will this affect the box office? Two, will we see an increase on the number of attacks against studios because of things like this? And finally, three, will a studio eventually crumble and give in to the demands and pay a ransom? And if so, does that then increase the number of attacks? I'm just fascinated to see how all the chips fall. And then let's talk about the story around Seth Rich. Seth was a Democratic National Committee staffer who was gunned down July 10th in Washington, D.C. Now, Seth Rich's murder has never been solved, but there are two main narratives. The first is that Seth Rich was murdered in a botched robbery. But police have said that they have no suspects, no witnesses, no motive. So there's that, and then there's the other belief that Seth Rich was killed because he was a whistleblower. They think he was a whistleblower, John Podesta, the Hillary camp, they weren't a fan of that, and all of a sudden this guy winds up dead. So those are the two worlds people are living in. But then the story was thrust into the spotlight last night thanks to Rod Wheeler, a former homicide detective and the family's private investigator. He spoke to Fox 5 in Washington, D.C., and he said this.
The police department nor the FBI has been forthcoming. They haven't been cooperating at all. I believe that the answer to solving his death lies on that computer, which I believe is either at the police department or either at the FBI. I've been told both.
But you have sources at the FBI saying that there is information
for
that
sure
could link Seth Rich to WikiLeaks?
Absolutely. Yeah, and that's confirmed. Actually, I have a source inside the police department that has looked at me straight in the eye and said, Rod, we were told to stand down in this case, and I can't share any information with you. Now, that's highly unusual for a murder investigation.
So the big claims there from Wheeler is that Seth was talking to WikiLeaks, which plays up to the whistleblower angle, and then he also alludes to there being some sort of cover-up with the police department. And then Fox News came out with a report saying that WikiLeaks connection, that's actually being corroborated by an anonymous federal investigator that spoke with Fox News. The source saying an FBI forensic report of Rich's computer generated within 96 hours after Rich's murder showed he made contact with WikiLeaks through Gavin McFadgen, a now-deceased American investigative reporter, documentary filmmaker and director of WikiLeaks who was living in London at the time, adding, I have seen and read the emails between Seth Rich and WikiLeaks, also claiming that the emails are in the possession of the FBI. So really big claims, but then back to Rod Wheeler, the story around him gets a little weird. While it does appear that Rod Wheeler is the family's private investigator, Seth Rich's family released a statement saying that that private investigator is being funded by a third party, and under his contract, he is supposed to be barred from speaking to the press without the family's explicit permission. And in the family's full statement, it doesn't appear that they believe in the validity that he was killed for being a whistleblower. Say, as we've seen through the past year of unsubstantiated claims, we see no facts. We have seen no evidence. We have been approached with no emails and only learned about this when contacted by the press. Even if tomorrow an email was found, it is not a high enough bar of evidence to prove any interactions as emails can be altered. And we've seen that those interested in pushing conspiracies will stop at nothing to do so. We are a family who is committed to facts, not fake evidence that surfaces every few months to fill the void and distract law enforcement and the general public from finding Seth's murderers. Adding that Wheeler was contractually barred from speaking to press or anyone outside of law enforcement or the family unless explicitly authorized by the family. The spokesman for the family also then going on to criticize Fox News, who is covering this, saying it's sad but unsurprising that a group of media outlets who have repeatedly lied to the American people would try and manipulate the legacy of a murder victim in order to forward their own political agenda. I think there is a special place in hell for people like that. Also, in response to Wheeler's claim that he talked to someone that said, we've been told to stand down, DC police responded to Fox 5 and said the claim that they've been told to stand down is false. And so that's where we are right now with this story. Now this is where everyone starts pointing fingers and everyone's disagreeing. There are a lot of people claiming that the Seth Rich story came up out of nowhere as a way to distract from the Trump-Russia story, which we're about to get to. But then you also have a good number of people who believe the Seth Rich story, that he wasn't just killed in a botched robbery, that he was killed because he was a whistleblower, saying that the Trump-Russia story is a way to distract from this story. Now, obviously you have a difference in the timeline. You have the Trump story happening first, the the Seth Rich story came out later that night, but it's also based off of a murder that happened last year. Maybe someone knew that information was gonna get out, so they beat him to the punch. So both parties here feel like they're validated, which is why, to do my part, I'm talking about both of these stories. So let's talk about that Trump story, which starts with a Washington Post headline reading, "Trump revealed highly classified information to Russian foreign minister and ambassador." Washington Post writing that according to former and current U.S. officials, Trump's disclosure jeopardized a critical source of intelligence on the Islamic State. Officials saying the information the president relayed had been provided by a U.S. partner through an intelligence sharing arrangement considered so sensitive that details have been withheld from allies and tightly restricted even within the U.S. government, adding that that partner had not given the United States permission to share the material with Russia, and Trump's decision to do so endangers cooperation from an ally that has access to the inner workings of the Islamic State. And so this had many up in arms, many saying, okay, so you fired James Comey while they're in the midst of a Russia investigation, right after you meet with Russian Ambassador Kislyak, who is in the center of the Russia investigation, and now we're hearing Trump sharing classified information with the Russians. Now, a big thing I want to note here is if this information is 100% true, that does not make it illegal for Donald Trump to have done so. The President of the United States has pretty broad authority as far as declassifying information. The main thing, the story breaks, people are freaking out, and the White House responds. Specifically, National Security Advisor H.R. McMaster goes out front of the White House and says this.
The story that came out tonight, as reported, is false. The president and the foreign minister reviewed a range of common threats to our two countries, including threats to civil aviation. At no time, were intelligence sources or methods discussed. And the president did not disclose any military operations that were not already publicly known. Two other senior officials who were present, including the Secretary of State, remember the meeting the same way and have said so. Their on-the-record accounts should outweigh those of anonymous sources. And I was in the room. It didn't happen.
And so the big things of note there to me is the specificity. The story as reported is false, and the statement at no time were any intelligence sources or methods discussed, and no military operations were disclosed that were not already known publicly. It's that specificity that sounds to me, and this is an opinion, it's the specificity that makes me feel like McMaster is saying that Donald Trump didn't say, you know, I'm talking about Agent A.A. Rogers in Taiwan who does this. But maybe he said something in that room that could have really only come from one or two sources. Because even the anonymous official that the Washington Post was talking to said that Trump was talking about a threat to the United States that could have only been learned through the espionage capabilities of a key partner. He did not reveal the specific intelligence gathering method, but he described how the Islamic State was pursuing elements of a specific plot and how much harm such an attack could cause under varying circumstances. Trump also revealing the city in the Islamic State's territory where the U.S. intelligence partner detected the threat. The argument being that just by sharing these classified breadcrumbs, the Russians or anyone they work with could find out where the source is. Also, the Russians denied it, specifically the Russian foreign minister going to Facebook to say yet another fake. People shouldn't read American papers. You can do other things with them, but you shouldn't read them. But then it's at this point of the story where I think it ends, and then I end up being wrong. The story doesn't end with the Washington Post and other outlets saying we have these sources that say that he gave up classified information, the White House, McMaster saying no, this story is false. Because then Donald Trump took to Twitter to say, as president, I wanted to share with Russia at an openly scheduled White House meeting, which I have the absolute right to do, facts pertaining to terrorism and airline flight safety. Humanitarian reasons, plus I want Russia to greatly step up their fight against ISIS and terrorism. So it appears that the president is saying he did share this information with Russia, which once again, I will say, he has the legal right to do from everything I've seen. But then goes on to go after the people who leaked this information, tweeting, I have been asking Director Comey and others from the beginning of my administration to find the leakers in the intelligence community. So then after the Trump tweets, H.R. McMaster goes out in front of reporters and answers a few more questions. And in response to the question, would you like to correct anything that you said yesterday, he said this.
No, I stand by my statement that I made yesterday. And what I'm saying is really the premise of that article is false, that in any way the president had a conversation that was inappropriate or that resulted in any kind of lapse in national security. And so I think the real issue, and I think what I'd like to see really debated more, is that our national security has been put at risk by those violating confidentiality and those releasing information to the press that could be used connected with other information available to make American citizens and others more vulnerable.
So hearing that, part of me goes, well, this might be why he was being so specific when he spoke yesterday. But then also the words change to a lapse of national security, and then he puts the blame on the media, which I won't argue against that leaks are a concern and are a news story that should be looked into, but as far as priorities go, it's not the highest. Also, to people hearing these stories, I mean, are you for or you're against leaks? Because it seems that people seem to flip-flop a lot based off of who the leaks are about. Also, an argument for McMaster seemed to be that the president couldn't have given given the source of the intelligence because he didn't know where it was coming from.
That the president wasn't even aware, you know, of where this information came from. He wasn't briefed on the source or method of the information either.
The problem with that argument is he's defending something that wasn't claimed. The claim was that he was talking about classified information that could make it easy for the Russians or any of their partners to find the source of the intelligence. And the last bit of information we're seeing now are reports that the source of the information that was shared is from Israel. This was initially reported by the New York Times, and NBC News said that this was real. This reportedly according to three sources. Now the concern there for many is if this is true, what does this do to U.S.-Israeli relations? As of right now, publicly, Israeli officials would not confirm if they were the source of this information. The Israeli ambassador to the United States sent an email statement to the New York Times reading, "Israel has full confidence in our intelligence-sharing relationship with the United States and looks forward to deepening that relationship in years under President Trump." And so it's understandable that with public statements like that and then all this other information coming from anonymous sources that seem invalid but then are verified, a lot of people don't know what to believe. And at the end of the day, really, it's perception is truth. And what I mean by that is the net result of this situation may be that allies don't share as much information with the United States. Whether the information coming out is true or not, really all that changes is who people see as the villain. Some people see it as President Trump in the White House, others say it's anonymous sources in the media. The main point, in the next month, Donald Trump might have a weird trip to Israel. And guys, of course, this is the Philip DeFranco Show. It is not just a show, it is a conversation. I'd love to know your thoughts about this last story, the first one, anything in between. And that's actually where I'm gonna end today's show. And remember, if you like this video, you like what I do on this channel, hit that like button. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button. Also, if you wanna take the next step, you can also support us on DeFrancoElite.com. Also, if you missed yesterday's Philip DeFranco Show, you wanna catch up on that, click or tap right there to watch. Also, if you wanna see the newest vlog, you can click or tap right there to watch that. But that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.